Ocala.
Minutes after 11 o'clock. Thank you for tuning in. One of the cool things about this job, Robin, is we get to meet some cool people.
The
very first time we spoke to Phil Proctor, I had no idea that I actually knew his work already. So maybe the second or third time we spoke to him, I actually used something similar as an intro, but I'm going to use it again. So before Rowena Martin's Laughing, I had to think about some of these comedy things. Before Saturday Night Live, before Mad TV, before Monty Python, okay? There was something called Firesign Theater.
Yes.
And I would listen to Firesign Theater when I was a kid, and these were like the Beatles of comedy, these guys. And I never really knew the guys. Like, for some reason, we knew all the names of the Beatles. I didn't really know all the names of the guys. Well, one of the names was Phil Proctor. and so I was a huge fan of Firesign Theater. And when Phil came on the first time, I think it was the very first time, and we were just talking about his biography and some of the things he's done. And one of the things was the voiceover for the dirty words that you can't put on a network TV. And I was so amazed that he was the guy who did Yippee Ki Yay Mr. Falcon on
On Die Hard,
thank you. Because I got a kick out of that, because obviously you can't say the real words that was on there. So he was the guy. And so that was my thing. Oh my gosh, we spoke to the guy who did Yippee Ki Yay Mr. Falcon.
Yeah.
And I gotta be careful not to say the other
one. Yes.
And then I found that all this other stuff he does, including Firesign Theater, and of course he's done so much more. He's on the phone again today. He is on, in addition to talking about the other things he's done, listen to this. He's an award-winning, Emmy award-winning actor, singer, songwriter, or writer. I don't know if he's a songwriter, but writer, it says, producer. He does movie voiceovers, as I mentioned. He's a member of the Firesign Theater, which I mentioned. I played on Broadway and off-Broadway, appears in numerous TV shows and films, voices the drunken French monkey in the Dr. Doolittle series, Howard in the Emmy award-winning Rugrats series, Seahorse Bob in Finding Nemo. I wonder if he's in the new movie. Working two Pixar movies, The Good Dinosaur and Inside Out, and he's got another one, Battlefield Earth, the audiobook, which we just talked about the other day, which is like 48 hours long or something.
47 and a half.
Something like that.
Yeah.
And he's got a new role cast as the eccentric Senator John Randolph in a three-part miniseries special titled Francis Scott Key After the Song. Phil Proctor, if I just read and read and read, I wouldn't have time to talk to you, so I'm going to stop. Good morning, Phil.
I'm exhausted just listening to those credits.
Yeah, yeah. Wow.
Have I really done all that, and am I still alive and still working? Oh, my God.
So you don't know from a fan's perspective, this is like, you're like talking to John Lennon. You're like the Beatles. I think I told you this once before.
That,
yeah.
Yeah. You're a rock star.
Yeah, and it's very kind of you to say that, because we actually were called the Beatles of Comedy when we were listed as one of the greatest acts of all time in Rolling Stone, I think it was, or Entertainment. Firesign Theater definitely had a tremendous impact, and we were very much, as you pointed out, ahead of the curve when we did our comedy recordings, because we were inspired in turn by radio. We were radio kids, and you know, so we lived in the world of the imagination much more than kids do today. And although where kids live today in cyberspace, you know, and this kind of telepathic communication that's going on constantly between everybody, it's a brand new scary world, but it's very interesting. Anyway, radio was that world for us. And we were given the toys to play with in a studio to create movies for the mind, to use all of the facilities that were available at the time, the technological facilities.
Right, right.
To take radio storytelling and character development and sound effects and music and everything, and take it to a higher level. So instead of doing comedy albums, which were recordings of our routines, we created specifically complicated, multi-layered stories that on disc that we knew people could listen to over and over and over again. So we packed it with all kinds of comedy on different levels.
And if I could do anything with the interviews with you and encourage somebody younger who's never heard of Firesign Theater.
Yeah,
I don't know where you would get it. I don't know if YouTube, whoever, or not YouTube, but iTunes, whoever has them, you got to download these things and just do something else while you're listening to them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, listen, if you Google Firesign Theater, you'll find all kinds of our stuff available, including a lot of our visual stuff, because we made several short films and there were, you know, tapes of our performances. We toured all over the country and ended up playing, like, you know, Carnegie Hall and all the Beacon Theater in New York, all kinds of really hot venues for the time. And that stuff is up there. But you can also just go to our website, firesigntheater.com, and, you know, there's availability of our various CDs and other recordings. They're available all over the place. And, yes, it's still very, very pertinent, because one of the other things that we did in our recordings and our writings was that we predicted. It was very science fiction-y. We predicted the future in many ways. And some of that stuff is still coming true. You know, most of it has already transpired, but some of it hasn't, you know, happened yet, but probably will.
Yeah, yeah. And the one thing I would add to that is that, and maybe you didn't even realize this, but at least because I don't know how much younger, but I'm just enough younger to be looking up to you at that in those years, that you had a hip, whatever is hip to kids was hip to me back then.
Yeah.
And you know, the way the Beatles were different than Elvis, you were different than whoever inspired you. Even though they were inspired by Elvis, for example, and Little Richard, you guys were different than the people who inspired you. Just hip enough that you kind of the next up, you know, the kids in middle school at that time, junior high school, whatever it was, were hip to it. We found that funny. We knew what you were talking about.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, we were inspired by the Beatles. We used to sit around in Peter Bergman's house in Laurel Canyon and with trembling fingers put the latest LP from the Beatles on a record player and sit down and just let it wash over us, because the Beatles were telling stories too.
Mm-hmm.
And the Beatles were using very, very interesting, thanks to their producer who passed away just recently, they were using all kinds of recording techniques to enrich their music.
Absolutely.
And enrich their storytelling.
Yes.
And a lot of, because of John Lennon's very psychedelic writing and his wordplay, a lot of the stuff that they, a lot of the music and the lyrics that they put out were challenging, you know, and stimulated your imagination. So we put references to the Beatles in the Nick Danger album, Cuckoo Ka-Choo. The Catherwood character makes references to it. And the Beatles were, we felt they were kind of our brothers. I ran into John Lennon once. I only had one contact with the boys, and I gave him a Not Insane button, because at the time we were running a fictitious character named Papoon, George Papoon, for president. And it was part of this whole surrealistic Martian Space Party movie that we made, and it was a crazy big deal. We appeared on the radio talking about his campaign. He enfranchised all the animals and the one-celled organisms. So that, you know, if somebody walked into a voting booth with a cold, he would be elected president immediately. Billions and billions of votes. So anyway, and Lennon wore the Not Insane button in several pictures that were taken of him.
Mm-hmm. I think I remember seeing that, yes. Oh, wow, so you're the one who gave it to him. Oh, that's
cool.
I actually handed it to him because I ran into him and told him how much, you know, he inspired us and how much I loved the Beatles at the time. But at the time that we were doing these records, the community of recording artists was very close-knit. We were all kind of hanging out together. You know, Dylan and Michael Oakes and Phil Oakes, excuse me, and the Rolling Stones. I sat in on a session of a mixing session of one of their albums, and Chad and Jeremy and all of these artists at the time were part of the growing record industry. See, the record industry wasn't this monster.
Yeah, right. Well, when people figured out that it made money, then all of a sudden the creative people had to take a back seat.
Right. The studios, the perfect example of it was we did most of our early recording at Columbia Records. at CBS Studios. And when the record industry started to take off, those studios were destroyed and made into little offices for all of the promotional selling the records.
Yeah. Oh no!
And these were studios that were existed from the radio days. They were studios where Bob Hope used to broadcast, and Jack Benny, and people, you know, they did all kinds of these radio shows, live
That is
and
amazing.
That's all history now, you know.
what a history you have. I just love talking to you, Phil, and the more I get to know you, the more fascinated, and the more starstruck I am, actually.
That's
just amazing to me.
Now, listen, I am looking at a map of Ocala here. I haven't visited Ocala yet. I performed in Florida on numerous occasions, but I haven't gotten to Ocala, and I noticed that you have a Beverly Hills nearby.
We sure do.
We do.
Well, that's where I'm calling from. however, it is, I guess it's not the same one.
My grandparents moved to that Beverly Hills in 1960 something, and yeah. I can remember the story that they moved from Connecticut. And they loaded their furniture onto the truck, and the truck went to Beverly Hills, California.
Oh, no!
Because nobody told the moving company there was another Beverly Hills, so, yeah.
Oh, that's terrible. Yeah. That's wonderful.
Yeah, so they slept on the cot for a while.
Whereabouts in Connecticut did they come from?
Milford, Connecticut.
Milford, okay. Well, as you mentioned, I'm going to be playing a role in a three-part PBS series called Francis Scott Key, After the Song, and I'm playing a very flamboyant senator from the time, which is like the 18th and early 19th century, named John Randolph. He was quite a character. He used to show up on the floor of the Senate with his two blonde Afghan hounds and his slave Juba, dressed in silks and, you know, all fancy stuff. And he himself had a riding whip, and he always appeared wearing riding boots with big spurs on them. And he had a high voice. It was annoying and shrills everybody. And he hours and hours on end on various causes. So I'm going to get a chance to do that role in Maryland. I'll be filming it in Maryland.
Oh, wow.
With a fellow named Philip Marshall, who's created this idea. The show will be shown in three parts during Black History Month, because it deals a lot with the freedom, the freeing of the slaves at that time.
Okay.
You know, the whole issue of slavery, which, you know, we're still struggling with today, you know, the repercussions.
Sure, yeah.
But anyway, it's going to be a very interesting thing, because it's based on interviewing the ghosts of these people, of these famous people. So I am a wraith, I'm a ghost, and I'm talking about my life and talking about the times and everything. In a high, shrill, annoying voice.
and a hint of a Southern accent, too, I can tell.
Yeah, and a hint. Well, we're still trying to figure that out, because, you know, he comes from Virginia. He's John Randolph of Roanoke. And they all had, you know, distinctive accents in those days. It wasn't the homogenized the way it is now. So people did have regional dialects that were, you know, that made them distinct, you know, and gave them character and all that. So we're playing with that, and that'll be fun. But afterwards, I'm going to Connecticut. I'm going to Avon, Connecticut.
Okay.
Where my wife comes from, West Hartford, and her mom passed away just about a 3 days shy of her 90th birthday.
Oh.
Last week, but she had a great life, great long life. Her name is Shirley Peterson, Shirley Kane Peterson, and so I'll be going then to a memorial service back in the beautiful Connecticut, the beautiful state of Connecticut. So that's worked out nicely for a change, you know?
Very cool.
They're flying me to Maryland, and then I can hop over to Connecticut. You know?
Oh, wow. That was
Tigger
cool.
Right there. That sounded like Tigger. All right. Let me see. I got to take a little break, and we'll be right back. Phil Proctor is our guest, and if you haven't already picked up on it, I mean, he is a superstar of superstars.
Exactly.
And so we're going to learn a little bit more about what's in the future. We've talked a lot about, a little bit about what's coming up, and a lot mm-hmm. about what happened already. So we'll take that break. Let me see. I got to push this button, and we'll be right back.
No, not that. Don't push that button.
All right, 22 minutes after 11 o'clock. Sound like you guys are having a good off-air conversation.
Yeah.
I want to be included in on some of that. All right, let's see. Phil Proctor is on the phone out in Beverly Hills. not California. Florida, California.
Many bills, as we call it these days.
And you so many credentials to flash and impress people with, and you seem so humble after all of that. Let's see, we wanted to talk a little bit about Battlefield Earth, right?
Sure, absolutely. That was an incredible experience. What I was saying to Robin was that one of the reasons I sound so humble is because my career and success has basically come from being an invisible man. You know, all of these voices that I've done for these extraordinary Academy Award-winning movies and all kinds of radio shows and audiobooks and what have you has brought me great fame and fun and a little fortune. But the main thing is that very few people know what I look like.
Yes, yes, I know. That's what's amazing to me too. I'm a big fan of Firesign Theater, but I'll tell you the truth. When I looked at your picture, not just this time, because I know you from a few years ago now.
Yeah.
But the first time, I said I don't recognize him. And how come?
That's right.
Because Firesign Theater was a record.
Yeah,
that's right. You know, it's not to say that I haven't had a career on television and in movies. I was the featured star of Tunnel Vision, which was a big success back in the 70s. And I was on All in the Family and Saint Elsewhere and all kinds of big television shows at the time. But I haven't done much of that in recent years. Although I have two movies out now, actually, when I think of it. One of them is a sex farce called Love Addict, in which I play a major role, and the other one is a sexy kind of political thriller called Window of Opportunity that's available online. So you know, I'm still acting.
There's a sexy person on your right arm in this one picture, Lauren Compton. She looks kind of sexy.
She's I don't know what picture you're looking at, but
she's in a loincloth.
Oh, yeah. That's Battlefield Earth. Oh, yeah. Yeah, working with her in the studio was really hot.
I bet it
and
was.
I took off most of her clothes.
No, I'm kidding.
Gotta be in character. One of the other funny things about doing the kind of work I do is that we had 67 actors who worked at Battlefield Earth, already top of the notch voiceover artists and character actors with great voices and great characterizations, but you seldom work together with them, you know? I played a banker and I played various Scottish rebels in the thing, and I would do my work pretty much in isolation. Once in a while, you get to work with another actor in the room, because there's interaction is necessary. But in the voiceover industry, more often than not, you're doing your work in limbo. You're doing your work in isolation and imagining what the other character sounds like. The same is done for the major animation movies. You know, there'll be a group of you who come in and work together, but you're still standing in front of the microphone very often doing your own character in isolation.
Wow.
And that's part of the challenge of it, and it's part of the fun of it, too. But in this instance, Battlefield Earth was such an epic project. And to be a part of it was really very thrilling, because the people who put these things together, I think it says there's like 1,500 sound effects and musical score and everything. So again, it's very Firesign Theater-y. They create a wonderful movie for the mind.
Yes, yes.
You can, you know, really lose yourself in. And the fact is, it's like, as you said, almost 48 hours. And this audiobook, which has already won numerous awards, which is a good thing for if you live in California, because in Los Angeles we spend so much time in our cars.
Yes.
Yes.
Well, that's when I would listen to it. That's what I would do in my car.
Yeah. Yeah. If you move the letters of Los Angeles around, it spells legs on sale.
Right? I love that.
That's
very
about
clever.
Says it all.
Oh, that's too funny. That's too funny. Hey, Phil, before we run out of time, tell me about Boomers on a Bench.
Oh, yeah. Thank you for asking. Boomers on a Bench is a little web series that I and a fellow crazy comedian named Jamie Alcroft, who is famous for our television show with Mac and Jamie, called Mac and Jamie, and has appeared, you know, he appeared mm-hmm. on Tonight Show and all this stuff. Anyway, what we're doing is we're doing two old codgers talking about the world. We sit there with newspapers and take off from there and talk about our lives and, you know, and our lack of lives and the problems that people of our age and of our era have in relating to the modern world. And it's a lot of fun. So if you just Google Boomers on a Bench, you'll see our YouTube site, and you'll see we've already done like a year and a half worth of, you know, they're like 3-4 minute pieces, and I hope people like them and subscribe to our service.
Okay, so the website I went to for you is planetproctor.com, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Planetproctor.com is my blog, which I've been doing for, 25 years or something like that. And I'm working on my memoirs now, which is called Where's My Fortune Cookie, and relates to the fact that I survived the Chinese gangland shooting.
Oh, how
fun. The Golden Dragon Massacre. Oh, great fun. Fun to talk about it now that it's over. At the time, it was the worst mass shooting in American history back in 1975, I think it was. 5 killed and 11 wounded.
Mm.
That was the biggest massacre in the history of the United States.
Wow.
How terrifying that it's changed so much.
In any event,
I'm going through all my pictures and all my memories, basically my garage, okay, and I find all these extraordinary pieces of material and photographs that bring back great memories of this long career. I told Robin, I've been doing this for 65 years. And the Firesign Theater.
Right. You still have the energy. You still have that same energy that you've always had.
Well, you know, that's the joy of being in the entertainment industry. You get to play. You get to remain childish. You get to remain in touch with your inner child and your imagination all the time.
Phil,
because you're challenged to create out of yourself.
I want to make sure we say a proper goodbye, because if we go up against the clock, it's going to sound like I'm rude. Phil Proctor, thank you so much. Go to Planet...
Always great talking to you guys. Thank you so much.
PlanetProctor.com. And for the Battlefield Earth, it's GoldenAgeStories.com, right?
Oh, yeah. It's a great, great listen. You're going to love it.
All right. And GoldenAgeTheater.com as well. Phil Proctor, always love having you on. And one day, if you're ever in Ocala... Maybe you'll be in the other Beverly Hills. You can come over here and do this in the studio.
That'd be great.
Good idea. I would love to do that, and I'll let you know if it's going to be possible, okay?
Yay!
Awesome.
All right,
I love talking to you. We will be right back.